Thank you, Jesus. He is an ever-present help. We're thankful for the Lord's presence today. Good morning. It's wonderful to see everyone here this morning. Thank you, Pastor Darren, for the opportunity to come and share. It's been quite a week for my family, my children. I've asked them, I'm leaving tomorrow to go to Cuba. And I've been asking my children, are you going to miss me? Going to miss me? They haven't said anything until today. So I know they're feeling a little nervous with Mama being gone, but they've got Granny, so they're in good shape. This morning, I just, in my heart, wanted to share with you about how the Lord comes alongside us and how he helps us in so many ways and ways that we are not always aware that the Lord is working to help us. But it's the end of the school year. Hooray for my children. And I want to take you back to, I went to George R. Stewart Elementary School. And at the end of the school year, it was always a wonderfully exciting time. All the classes participated in field day. This event was loads of fun and full of excitement. The competition was hot. And classes were pitched against each other competing. Trust me, you did not want to be on the losing side or get a yellow ribbon, because a yellow ribbon was given to those students who participated. Yes, teachers did not want us to feel left out, but there was such joy and the intense power of competition. It was too powerful to resist. In first grade, Mr. Pruitt, God rest his soul, decided to test the girls for the 50-yard dash. Now, don't try to picture this in your minds, but I was just a little whisper of a thing. That day, Mr. Pruitt divided the class into three groups and then took the top runners from each group and made them run to see who would be the two top picks for each class. Yay! I won the race in my group! I started feeling really, really confident. As Mr. Pruitt gathered the rest of the top runners together, I kept thinking, I'm going to win. I'm going to win. I'm going to win. I was super excited and ready for the race. He called us up to the line and blew the whistle, which he was a PE teacher, and he kept twirling that whistle around his fingers every time we saw him. So he called us up to the line. We got ready. On your mark, get set, go. I took off and I was doing great. The students were cheering and I felt powerful until out of the corner of my right eye, I saw my doom. Her name was Kathy. And somehow she got a burst of power from somewhere and turned on the speed. She was not only catching up with me, she was passing me, and I panicked. I dug deep and I was determined to catch up and pass her. But as I reached the line to turn around, all hope was gone. I sadly ran the rest of that race knowing that I had been beaten. The one time I stepped completely out of my comfort zone to do something I had never done and would never do again. I lost, and I was crushed. But then on field day, I discovered that I had a new talent, and that was the softball throw. I won a blue ribbon that year and every year until Edna showed up in the sixth grade. I have often thought about this race and how powerfully my friend came up beside me. It reminds me that we are all in a race, reaching toward a much higher and holier goal. Once Christ comes into our heart, a transformation takes place, and he begins forming and molding our character into his image. I love how Paul says, until Christ is formed in you. This means many things. 2 Corinthians 3:16 through 18 says this, but whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory are being transformed into his image with ever increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. The transformation process in us is not a one-time thing. Wouldn't it be great if it were? But this is not God's design. God takes us as we are, with our faults, our wrong attitudes, our greatly damaged hearts, and He breathes life into us. As my Josephine so aptly says, when you get saved, Jesus puts perfume in your heart. This new life in us is now in fellowship with Christ, the Christ who redeems us, the Christ who liberates us, the Christ who heals us, the Christ we suffer with, the Christ who says, trust me, the Christ, the anointed one, the Christ who weeps with us, the Christ who is God with us, Emmanuel. He's the one who searches us and knows us, the one who knows when I sit and when I rise, the one who perceives our thoughts from afar and who discerns our going out and our lying down, the one who is familiar with all our ways. Before a word is on our tongue, my friends, He knows it completely. The one who hems us in behind and before and lays His hand upon us. Verse 5 through 10 of Psalm 139 says, such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, behold, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. He is the God who comes alongside us. And to make certain that we know He has not left us to journey alone, Christ speaks to us from John 14. He says, and I will ask the Father, and He will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees Him nor knows Him. You know Him, for He dwells with you and will be in you. He is the God who comes alongside us. The Holy Spirit comes alongside us to help us work in our hearts, and we are not always aware of what He is doing. Life has a way of grabbing our attention through suffering, through hardship, through sickness, and through our families, through others. It grabs our attention. We cry, we moan, we plead with God, and yet we find ourselves still smack dab in the middle of difficulties. Gentlemen, I don't know about you, but ladies, we gather and share together. We grab friends and ask for prayer. But whether you are male or female, it's not over until it's over. David, out of Psalm 139, has his heart completely open to God. And he's saying, God, you know everything about me. There is nothing in me that can hide from you. Wherever I go, Lord, your presence is there. His presence is always there. And the Holy Spirit is working alongside us, even when we feel zipped, when we feel exhausted, or when we have to tell our child one more time not to do that thing, or even when we get a bad report from the doctor, or when our loved one slips into eternity. His presence is with us permanently, because Christ did that on the cross so that our relationship with God is sealed for all time. We may flounder in our work, my friends, in our understanding of what God is doing, because we are so focused in other areas. But I want to encourage you today, God is at work. Several years ago, in 2016, I had a thought about something that I really needed from the Lord, and I didn't even pray about it, but it was just a thought in my heart. And 2 weeks ago, the Holy Spirit put a new set of glasses on my spiritual eyes and showed me that He had not only responded to my thought, but He had given me the answer from the beginning. But I just couldn't see it. He has been steadily working alongside, laying tracks, moving ahead with His work. And I realize that the Spirit works concurrently alongside of us. While we may be in the dark, He never is. But the vein of the Spirit moves. There's not a moment that the Holy Spirit trips. There's not a moment that the Holy Spirit has to say, oops. He never says any of those things. But when he's ready, he's a revealer. And he will reveal our hearts. He will reveal himself to us in a way that the world cannot understand, that the world cannot see. But it is up to us while we're having the dark night of the soul to hold on to the God that we know, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God who walks with us through his word, because his word is alive and it's going to accomplish what he set it out to do. That's the kind of God that I'm talking about. He walks with us. What a comfort to know that he is guiding us and teaching us and helping us. And the Holy Spirit's name in Greek is so rich. We don't even have enough English words to describe who he is or what he does. Our language has limitations, but he has none. Praise him. Romans 8:3-6 says this about how we view and work with the Spirit. It says, the law of Moses was unable to save us because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. He sent his own son in body, like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his son as a sacrifice for our sins. We might have a struggle in our flesh, but the Bible says that sin is no longer our master because Christ did that work on Calvary. Verse 4, he did this so that the just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things. But those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about the things that please the Spirit. So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death. We know the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. But letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. God's work and plan through the Holy Spirit's coming is glorious indeed. The Holy Spirit has done things among us that we are still talking about 100 years later. We need his presence and guidance. We need the love that he puts in our hearts for one another. We have many plans and goals, and we need to know how to move forward. My friends, anything you or I do is pale in comparison to the Spirit's work. David knew the Lord's presence was vital to everything he ever did. David responds to God's presence. Psalm 139. And I want to encourage you, if you have a moment today, read that chapter of Psalms. He starts in verse 7. I can never escape from your Spirit. I can never get away from your presence. He says, if I go up to heaven, you are there. If I go down to the grave, you are there. If I ride the wings of the morning, if I dwell by the farthest oceans, even there, your hand will guide me and your strength will support me. Can you imagine as a young girl watching my dad fly and travel and be around the world? My mom said that one year dad was gone 285 days out of the year. The Lord kept my dad. The Lord kept his hand on my father. The Lord kept his hand on my mother. She was raising 7 children. And now I can stand up and proclaim the word of God, because while my dad was traveling, the Holy Spirit was doing a work in my heart. And he was preparing the way ahead of me. And he was preparing a way for me to proclaim his good news. Verse 11, I could ask the darkness to hide me and the light around me to become night. But even in the darkness, I cannot hide from you. And who knows that the Holy Ghost does some of his best work in the dark when we don't see what he's doing. To you, the night shines as bright as day. Darkness and light are the same to you. Verse 13, you made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion and as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. name. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumbered the grains of sand. And when I wake up, you are still with me. Oh God, if only you would destroy the wicked. Get out of my life, you murderers. They blaspheme you. Your enemies misuse your name, but thank God, one day God's going to clear his name. Oh Lord, shouldn't I hate those who hate you? Shouldn't I despise those who oppose you? Yes, I hate them with total hatred, for your enemies are my enemies. And then David ends his openness and talking to the Lord and declaring his presence and saying, Lord, you come alongside me with this. He says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life. My friends, we don't walk this journey alone. Even in our darkest moments, even in the midst of our suffering, even when things don't work out right, even when we're trying to get work done and nothing seems to be going, we are still never alone. The enemy would like to isolate us. He would like to isolate what we think. He would like to isolate our work. He likes to jab us when we feel the most vulnerable. But even when he jabs us, the Holy Spirit is still there, working and moving and helping and laying tracks of faith. And when the Holy Ghost is ready, hallelujah, hallelujah, blessed be his holy name, he'll put on those Holy Spirit glasses. And then he'll begin to show you his work, what he's been doing in your heart all along. Not just for you, but for your children and for your grandchildren and for generations that come after you. Why? Because the Lord said he comes alongside us. He said he won't just be with you, but he'll be in you. And even in our times of darkness, even in our times when we feel alone, he comes alongside us. God bless you. Amen.